looking at here is called a fractal. A geometric shape with a very complex and usually also self-similar structure. Famous examples of these that you might have seen already are, for example, the Mandelbrot set or the Koch snowflake from my other video. But unlike a simple geometric shape like a rectangle, they are a bit more complicated to define, create and render. This fractal, as well as the Mandelbrot set, are defined by a mathematical process called an iterated method, where you define a certain function which you basically feed into itself. Let's illustrate this with an example. Let's define a function as f of x equals x plus 1. To create an iterative process out of this, let's choose a starting value, for example 0, and put that into the function. Now we can link the output of our function to its input, and we have an infinite recursion. This function isn't particularly interesting, however, as it just goes off to infinity for any starting value. The function f of x equals x squared is a bit more interesting to investigate. As we know, if we square a number, it usually just gets larger. However, if the number is smaller than 1, it actually becomes smaller. And by repeating our squaring, it eventually becomes infinitely close to 0. 1 is another special case in itself, as it just stays where it is, no matter how often you square it. We might consider visualizing this by coloring the different behaviors of our starting values on the real number line in different colors. Well, now that I have tricked you into watching a video about iterated methods, let me tell you about the big star of today's show, Newton's method. In school, you might have learned about how to find roots of linear functions, or perhaps even one of these abominations for polynomials of degree 2. But how can you find roots of higher order polynomials, for example? Turns out, you can derive even worse looking formulas for degrees 3 and even 4. But beyond that, no formulas exist anymore. So a few hundred years ago, the absolute legend Isaac Newton and the far fewer mentioned Joseph Raphson came up with a genius method. Let's visualize a random function and let's pick a starting point somewhere around the area where we might think a root could be. To move towards the root, we could check where the function is heading by drawing the tangent at the point and then seeing where the tangent intersects the x-axis. The tangent can be described by the following equation using the derivative, meaning the rate of change of the function at that point. Now this is nothing but a linear function, for which, if you remember, we already discussed finding the root earlier. This new x value is now closer to the root, and if we then take the function value at the new x value, we can repeat the procedure and eventually get pretty much infinitely close to our root. Now this is a pretty magical and well-working method, but there are a few things that can go wrong depending on where we start. In this slightly more advanced example, things that can go wrong include getting stuck at a minimum or maximum of the function, as the tangent in that point never crosses the x-axis at all, or overshooting our target with starting values like here, which can lead to either infinite hopping around or reaching a different route than we were intending. To visualize this behavior, we could again color the different starting points in a certain color, representing the route it converges towards, which already created an interesting pattern in some areas. Now, for example, a polynomial of degree 3 has, by the fundamental theorem of algebra, exactly 3 roots. Don't believe me? Let's factorize the expression, and if we plug in any of the parentheses values, the whole thing becomes 0, meaning we have found a root. As we have 3 of these, we have 3 roots. Now what if a polynomial looks like this, you may ask? Well, I never said the roots would have to be real numbers, did I? Now if you're a bit scared of complex numbers, don't worry about it. For all our purposes here, you can just think of a complex number as a vector of two real numbers with some funny multiplication logic under the hood. That way, we can visualize them as a 2D coordinate system. As a matter of fact, we could ask ourselves if we can apply our Newton iteration to complex numbers as well. Well, our polynomial and derivative just stay the same. Instead of the usual division, we do complex division, which is a bit funnier, but it works the exact same, and taking the power of a complex number can also just be done by repeatedly taking the product. But we might get back to that topic later. Well, now we have everything to build our visualization. We initialize the grid of our real complex number plane, we choose a polynomial, for example x³ minus 1, we evaluate the Newton method for every single coordinate, and then we color each coordinate depending on which of the three roots it converges towards. Wait, every single coordinate? How can we compute that within finite time? Even if we take every single pixel on our conventional 1920 by 1080 monitor, that's still a few imaginary numbers to calculate. If only we had a device that could do these independent calculations massively in parallel. Oh, wait. Using the GPU, we can actually run this iteration in real time, meaning we can also add controls for moving around and zooming, and it will all be executed in real time with a stable 162 FPS on my RTX 3070. Nice, let's try out a higher order polynomial. Wow, such cool shapes. Let's try zooming in a bit. Oh. Well, turns out taking lots of powers of imaginary numbers during polynomial evaluation can bring even a 300 euro used graphics card to its knees. There is a small trick we can use here, however. We can convert an imaginary number into its polar form by calculating its radius and rotation, meaning the imaginary number is equal to its polar representation, which also means the nth power of the imaginary number is equal to the radius to the power of n times the sine and cosine expression to the power of n. The left part here is already nice, because the radius is a real number for which we can use the fast built-in power function of the GPU. And the right-hand side, using a really cool trick called
Moivre's
formula, is actually equal to the sine and cosine of the product of n and the angle. Meaning we have reduced imaginary exponentiation to real exponentiation and a single evaluation of a sine and cosine function respectively, which is a lot more efficient and makes our simulation go from this to this. Thank you so much for watching. If you're curious about the visualization shown in the video, you can visit the link in the description to try it out for yourself, as well as the GitHub link if you're curious about any of the code behind it. I hope you enjoyed this video as much as I did the journey of exploring and visualizing this topic to its fullest. Thanks again and see you!